let someone pay.
Yes, sir.
Good morning and welcome to Londonderry Christian Church. We're here to love one more. I'm so glad you chose and joined us this morning, whether that's here in person, if you're watching from home. We're so glad you come to worship our great God with us today. A few things I want to make you aware of. The first one is, if this is your first time checking us out here at Londonderry Christian Church, I encourage you to go to our church website, londonderrychristianchurch.com, and click connect. There you can fill out our online connect card. It's a great way for us to connect with you and for you to connect with us. And so I encourage you to please do that so that we can each be growing together in our journey following Jesus. I also want to make you aware of some stuff that's coming up here in a few weeks here at the church. The first one is we have coming up on Saturday, February 5th, is our next Ladies Let's Connect brunch. That's at 10 a.m. on that Saturday. All ladies are invited to come for a time to share some food together, to connect together, build relationships together. So it's a great time for the ladies to come connect. So ladies, put that on your calendars for Saturday, February 5th at 10 a.m. Then also we have coming up on Saturday, February 19th, is our next men's breakfast at 8 a.m. And again, another great time for guys to get together, to come connect, share some food together, eat some bacon, and pray together. And so men, you're invited for that. Put it on your calendars, February 19th, 8 a.m. Join us for that. And also to make you aware of a pretty big change that we have coming up. So we're making a change starting in 2 weeks on Sunday, February 6th. We're going to combine into one service and start having one service at 10 a.m. on Sundays. So our plan had been, we've been working towards getting back to normal with the COVID-19 pandemic that's been going on. But it just keeps going on. And so we're almost to 2 years of pandemic life, and we're not yet at a place to be back to normal in the way we would like to be. And so we've done some combined services, and when we've been together, that's been really awesome. It's been great to have the church together, to see most of our congregation together. And so we're just going to make that switch. Starting Sunday, February 6th, we're going to offer one service at 10 a.m. So we'll have our kids class at 10 a.m. And so it'll be a chance for us to gather together as one body to continue working to build our community together as we seek to also reach out and love one more and help more people join us here at Londonderry Christian Church to come meet and find and follow Jesus. So an email will be going out today with more about that change so that you can know that. But I just want to make you aware that starting not next Sunday, the following Sunday, we're having one service at 10 a.m. And so we look forward to having you join us for that as we move forward with one service together, joining together in fellowship and being together as God's people at 10 a.m. So we're continuing our series we started last week called What's That Mean? As we explore different words that we use in the church that we may not really know what they mean. And so we're going to explore one of those words today. And so if you would, let's say our series verse together out of the book of Acts, Acts chapter 2, verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you have called us to be your people, that you have chosen us, that you have saved us, and God, that you are now at work in us, making us more and more like Jesus. So, Father, I pray that as we gather together today around your Son, may your Spirit and your Word be at work to transform us and make us more and more like Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Morning, church. My name is Mark, and I'm joined by Matt and Mickey. We're going to start off singing a couple songs and praise to God this morning. So if you'd like to stand up and sing along with us, you're welcome to do so.
Wash away my sin, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. My head up, your grace. My sin is washed away. This is how I know you're my Lord. That in my weakness you give me the strength to be restored. This is how I know I'm adored. That when I'm lost in my feelings, you tell me I am yours in the light of your grace. You rend my darkness in the light of your grace. My burdens lose their weight in the light of your grace. You lift my head up in the light of your grace. My sin is washed away. Water, walk on the way. This is how I know I am yours. This is how I know I'm secure. This is how I know you're my Lord. This is how I know I'm adored. In the light of your grace, you rend my darkness. In the light of your grace, my burdens lose their weight. In the light of your grace, you lift my head up. In the light of your grace, my sin is washed away. Head out of water.
Truth in the words, Lord, that on our own we are lacking, God, that we don't deserve to come into your presence, but God, in the light of your grace, you lift our heads up, you end our darkness, our burdens lose their weight, God, our sins are washed away. Lord, we praise you for that this morning. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. You can have a seat.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Dave. I'm the preaching pastor here at Londonderry Christian Church. You'd think I was not a public speaker, but... So as we dive in this morning, I want to take a few moments and talk with our kids who are here with us or who are watching from home. And so what I want to do this morning is I want you to use your imaginations. Okay, I'm going to give you a scenario that's a what if. And I want you to think about that scenario and how you would feel. So here's our first one. What if you're at school one day, it's recess, you're playing and having a ton of fun, you're playing tag with your friends, and you're chasing your best friend. And all of a sudden, you trip on a rock, and you fall, and you skin your knee. And hurts so bad, maybe it's bleeding a little bit, and you like hobble over to your teacher, and you walk over and you're like, my leg, and your teacher goes, that looks like it hurts, I'll pray for you. How would you feel? I'd probably be like upset, like, what? I'm bleeding, at least give me a Band-Aid. Or what if you walk over to your best friend's house and you guys are playing all day, having so much fun, doing all of your favorite things. And then it comes time for you to walk home and it starts pouring down rain. And because when you came, it was a bright sunny day, you don't have rain boots or a raincoat or an umbrella. But there, sitting right next to the door of your friend's house, are extra rain boots, an extra raincoat, and an extra umbrella. And you look, you're like, and your friend says, have a good walk home. Don't get too wet. how would you feel? I would be upset at my friend, like, are you kidding me? You got boots and a raincoat and an umbrella. I could be dry. But you didn't even offer them. Or what if growing up, no one ever told you how much God loves you? How would you feel? I'd be really sad. Because you'd have missed out on the greatest gift there is, to know that God has sent his son Jesus for you. Now, why these what-if scenarios? Why these thoughts? Because the Bible tells us that if we are followers of Jesus, we don't show love just in words. It's not enough to tell someone, oh, you're hurt, I'll pray for you. But to do what we can to help them with their hurt, to go help bandage the knee, put some medicine on it, get a Band-Aid. If we have something that someone needs, we don't just go, don't get wet. We offer it to them. And most of all, we tell people about the most amazing gift God's given, which is his son, Jesus. That to be a follower of Jesus means to put God's love into action. And that's what we're going to talk about this morning. We're going to talk about how we can put God's love into action, how we can live out the calling God's given us. So again, as we've been trying to do, each series that we go through, we have a verse for our series. And our goal is, by the end of the series, to have that verse memorized. So we're going to go ahead and say our series verse together again out of Acts chapter 2, verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Awesome. Good job. Next week, I will take out a bunch of words and see how well we can do. So last week, we started this series, What's That Mean?, exploring different words that we use in the church. And last week, we looked at the word fellowship. And normally in the church, we use the word fellowship like this. Hey, y'all, we're having a, well, at least if you're in the South. Hey, y'all, we're having a ladies brunch. Or, hey, guys, we're having our men's breakfast. And we throw out the three F's. Come join us for some food, some fun, and some fellowship. Yeah! What's that?
Fantastic.
Yeah, there you go. The four F's. The fantastic four. But we would talk about fellowship as if what we mean by fellowship is, hey, come join us to connect and have conversation. Which is an aspect of fellowship. But fellowship is so much bigger than that. It's not about having coffee or food together. That fellowship, we looked at last week, is both a state of being, which means it's a reality that we live in. And that reality is that all of us are both individually and as a community sons and daughters of the King. We have this shared identity that bonds us together and that leads us to shared activity. Fellowship is both a state of being and activity. It's who we are and it's what we do together. So some of that is how we spend time building relationships. So there is an aspect of fellowship to a ladies' brunch or a men's breakfast or a movie night or a service activity. Those are opportunities to build our sense of bonding. But it's not just those things. It's bigger than that. And it's what we do. And so today we're going to look at a word that flows out of fellowship. That as we are connected together as one body, who are all sons and daughters of the King, brothers and sisters together in the family of God, that then leads us to joint activity. And part of that activity is the word we're going to look at today, which is the word ministry. It's a word we use in the church. Now, I grew up in a small church in southern Illinois, and when I heard the word ministry, what I thought that meant, that ministry was what the preacher did. So we paid this guy to come and every week talk to us about Jesus. We paid him to come sit in his office during the week. We paid him, if he got sick, he'd come say hi to you in the hospital. And I understood that that's what ministry was. Ministry was done by a paid professional, and everybody else just came to church on Sunday and had a good time. If you're lucky. But that's not what the New Testament teaches about ministry. So the New Testament defines ministry as ministry means to serve in faith through the Spirit's power. Ministry means to serve in faith through the Spirit's power. So at its root, the word behind our English word ministry is the Greek word diakoneo, or the noun form is diakonos. And what that means is someone who serves. Now, in its original context, diakoneo was used of somebody who waited on tables. So it was a servant, well, not really a servant, it was a slave in the household whose job was to bring food to the master of the house who's sitting at the table and his family members. That slave's job was to serve them. In the ancient Greek world, no person would voluntarily diakoneo. No one would voluntarily serve in that capacity. It had to be forced, which is why only slaves did it. Now, when we come to the New Testament, this crazy thing happens. Jesus comes on the scene. God has become flesh. He's turning everything upside down. And Jesus shows us that in his kingdom, it's the opposite. It's not the master of the house who sits there and eats the food. It's the king of all things who gets down and serves. And so we're going to see in the New Testament how for God's people, serving, waiting on tables, this word that was used only for slaves, is now the expectation for God's people. That ministry means that we serve in faith. That the reason we take this lowly position is because we believe in Jesus. That we're following the King who did this, and the way we do it is through the Spirit's power. So at its core, the word ministry means to serve. So whenever we use the word ministry, it's about serving. Hey, come join us in the men's ministry. It's meant to be a ministry that serves men. Hey, come join us in the women's ministry. It's a ministry that serves the women. That whatever we attach the word ministry to, it should be about serving. That we're doing something to serve someone else. And so we're going to look at this word. And as we explore what ministry means, there are a few questions we want to answer as we go through. Our first question is this. If ministry means to serve God in faith through the Spirit's power, then who do we serve? So ministry means to serve God and others. Ministry means to serve God and others. So that in our serving, we're serving God, and the way we serve God is by serving other people. And this is connected back to the great commandment. When Jesus asked, what's the greatest commandment? He says, love God with everything that you are. Your body, heart, soul, mind, all that you are, your strength, everything. Love God with all you are. And the second and commandment that's like it is to love your neighbor as you love yourself. What Jesus is telling us there is that the way that we show love to God is by loving other people. So if you want to love God, you love others. The same thing is true in when we serve. If you want to serve God, you serve others. So ministry means to serve God and to serve others. Look at Luke chapter 22, starting in verse 24. It says, a dispute also arose among them as to which of them was considered to be greatest. Jesus said to them, the kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who exercise authority over them call themselves benefactors. But you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who is at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. You are those who stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you a kingdom, just as my Father conferred one on me, so you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Jesus says, in my kingdom, we're not like the world, where their kings use power and coercion and fear and threats to get people to do what they want. They lord it over them. And then they say, ha ha, look at me, I'm a benefactor. I'm so great. He says, not that way in my kingdom. He says, who is greater? The one who sits at the table or the one who waits on the table? And they know the answer. The answer is, of course, the one who sits there. Like, if you're sitting there and everybody's bringing you food, like these movies you see of ancient kings where, like, they have, you know, holding grapes for them and the palm branch, like, that person's the one in charge. They're the one being lazy. But he says, but I, being the king of all things, came to you as a servant. I've come and served you. And he says he's going to give us a kingdom where we will sit at the table and he will serve us as we then serve. That those who follow Jesus, we are called to serve. Because we're following the way and example of Jesus. So as we serve God and we serve others, this is what Jesus is telling us, is that serving is central to his kingdom. If you're going to be a part of the kingdom of Jesus, the expectation is that you will serve others. This is not a suggestion. This is not a hopeful thing. Jesus expects if you are his follower, you will follow his example and serve. This is why, as a church, we have on the wall right over there our core values, one of which is everyone in ministry. Because the expectation is, as followers of Jesus, every one of us should be engaged in serving God and others. It's not for just a select few. It's not the pastoral staff in ministry, or the elders in ministry, or the ministry leads in ministry, or whoever. It's all of us in ministry. It's all of us together serving God and others. And that goes back to fellowship. That fellowship is both an individual thing. It's something that's true for me, but also true for all of us. And that it's all of us engaged in joint activity. All of us serving together is how we continue to build our fellowship. So we're to serve God and to serve others. So that's who we serve. So the next question is, what do we serve? So ministry means to serve both the body and the spirit. Ministry means to serve both the body and the spirit. That who we serve is God and others. What we serve is serve both the body and the spirit. Look at Acts chapter 6, starting in verse 1. Acts chapter 6, we're going to start off in verse 1. It says, in those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the day distribution of the food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, it would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them and will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the Word. This proposal pleased the whole group. They chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. Also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. So the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. So the book of Acts, we get a history of the beginning of the church. And so in Acts chapter 2, Peter, empowered by the Holy Spirit, stands up and gives the first sermon of the church. And it says that 3,000 people begin to follow Jesus. And that's where we get the verse, that's our series verse, Acts 2:42. It was those 3,000 new disciples, along with the apostles, who devoted themselves, the apostles' teaching, to the breaking of bread, to fellowship, and to prayer. I got those out of order, but it's in there. They devoted themselves to those things. And so the church begins to grow as they begin to have fellowship together. They're sharing together and they're learning about Jesus. They're sharing in their new identity. They're sharing their money together, providing for each other. And the church is growing and growing and growing. And we get to Acts chapter 6, where the church has grown to a point that they've started this food ministry or food service, where what's happened is, in their culture, when a woman's husband died, If she didn't have kids, she was destitute. Because the woman couldn't get a job, couldn't work and earn her own money, and so it was the man who provided. So if the husband died, if her kids didn't provide for her, she was going to starve. And so the church realizes this is not how Jesus calls us to serve others, so we're going to provide a food ministry to the widows. And in that ministry, there begins to be a problem where the widows of Hebrew background are getting fed, but the widows of Greek background are getting overlooked. And that's not good. We can't have people going without food. And so the apostles decide that they should appoint 7 men full of wisdom of the Holy Spirit to oversee this ministry of serving food. Now, it's not because they thought that ministry was beneath them, but they had a very specific commission from Jesus. Jesus told them to go into all the nations, to make disciples, teach them to obey his teaching, and to baptize them to become his followers. That's the commission of the apostles. And so they said, this food ministry is valuable, it's important, but it's not our calling. So they raise up 7 others to oversee that. And you notice what happens. So as these 7 oversee the food ministry, the apostles stay focused on their calling. It says the word of God spread, and the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. That ministry serves both the body and the spirit. That ministry means to serve both physical needs and spiritual needs. You know, that there was a time when I thought that ministry was about spiritual needs. You know, it's about preaching the gospel. It's about teaching the Bible. It's about doing discipleship with people. That's ministry. But that's a part of ministry. But ministry is also making sure people have food to eat, clothes to wear, shelter to live in. That it's meeting those physical needs as well. That it's both things. That ministry is both meeting spiritual and physical needs. I mean, that's what we try to do as a church. That's why we have our Sunday services where we can gather together and we can connect with each other and we can connect with God, that we can proclaim the gospel every week and hear about Jesus. But it's also why we provide backpacks to kids in town with school supplies and Thanksgiving baskets and serve at the soup kitchen and do all kinds of other stuff that we do, because to be serving God and others means to meet both physical and spiritual needs. That we want to be people who help others discover what God's doing by meeting those needs. And we see that this is part of what God's called us to in what Paul says in Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20, verse 22, Paul says, "And now, compelled by the Spirit, I'm going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me. The task of testifying to the good news of God's grace." That the word it uses there, task, is our word diakoneo. The ministry or the service of testifying to the good news of God's grace. And the way we testify to that, we see in Paul's life, that Paul sought to meet both physical needs and spiritual needs. He brought healing places and he shared the gospel. And that as a church, we want to be about that. We want to be about serving people, helping to meet those needs so that we can help people discover who Jesus is, so that we can help them know how much God loves them. So ministry means to serve both the body and the spirit. So if who we serve is God and others, what we serve is the body and the spirit. So the next question is then, how do we serve? How do we put this into action? So ministry means to serve using the gifts that God has given each of us. Ministry means to serve using the gifts that God has given each of us. Look at 1 Peter chapter 4, starting in verse 10. Does each of you should use whatever gift you've received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. Peter writes and says that each of us should use whatever gift you've received to serve others. What the Bible teaches is that if you are a follower of Jesus, if you've been baptized into Christ, you've received the forgiveness of your sins, you've been empowered with the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit has given you spiritual gifts, and that you are called to use those gifts to serve God and others. That every believer who's been baptized into Christ has received a spiritual gift, or maybe spiritual gifts. You may have more than one. That's true for all of us. Which again is why our core value is everyone in ministry. All of us have been given gifts by God to use to serve Him and others. Now, there are a couple different ways to understand spiritual gifts. And so in my study, there are kind of two ways I understand these gifts could happen. So spiritual gifts could happen in one of two ways. One way is that your spiritual gifting by God is a completely supernatural gifting. What I mean by that is that you have a gift now that you didn't have before. So it's something that you were never good at. After meeting Jesus, receiving the Holy Spirit, now all of a sudden you have this gift that came out of nowhere. An example could be, before following Jesus, you were a hard-hearted person. Whenever you'd watch TV and that commercial comes on with a little cute puppies, they need support and they just need your money, and you're just like, oh, the puppies! And you'd see it and you go, I don't care. They're dogs. I don't have dogs. I'm not paying no money for those dogs. You don't care. You are hard-hearted. Then you met Jesus, and your life changed, and now you're this overly compassionate person that you see that commercial and like you melt to a puddle of tears. That whenever someone shares with you the struggle they're facing, like your heart hurts for them because you see their pain and you're overwhelmed with compassion. That's a supernatural gift. You weren't that way before. God did a work in you. And now, you can't explain it other than you met Jesus, and now you're this way. That's one version of a spiritual gift. You didn't have it before. Now you do. Another way you can have a spiritual gift is, God takes a natural ability that He's already given you, and He amplifies it after you begin following Jesus. So there was something maybe you were good at before, but now God has like harnessed it for His kingdom in a way that you're way better at it than you were before, and it's making a profound impact in serving God and others. So it could be like before you were pretty good at administration, you know, you like details, but now that you follow Jesus, like you're involved in the church and you see all these ways that you can help figure stuff out and administrate and organize and plan, and it's like God's just using your gifting in an amazing way. That's where He takes what you were good at and it's like adds jet fuel to it, and you're amazing at it for the church. So those are spiritual gifts. And the Bible says that all of us, meaning each of us, if you're a follower of Jesus, have been given spiritual gifts. Now, if you hear that and you go, cool, I have no idea what my gifts are. We have a class that we run, LCC 103, Discover Your Gifts. And if you've never figured out what your gifts are, if we have enough people, we could run the class, or we could do one-on-one classes and kind of help you go through what your gifts are. As part of that, we have a survey or a test that we have you take, and you answer questions and helps you figure out what your spiritual gifts are. If you don't know and would like to know, you can email me or talk to me, and we'll get you hooked up with that test, and we can sit down and talk with you afterwards about here's what the test says, and here's some ways that you can plug into the church to use those gifts that God's given you to serve God and others. All of us have been given gifts, and there's a wide variety of gifts that can be used in the church. Gifts like teaching, administration, mercy, helping, leadership, encouragement and exhortation, like all kinds of stuff, all different ways that we can serve and God wants us to serve. And what's important for us to know is that all of our gifts are needed and necessary for the church. That whatever gift God has given you, your gift is needed for Londonderry Christian Church to be what God wants it to be. That He has given us gifts, and all of us need to use our gifts for the benefit of God's church. Look at what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. He says, "So Christ Himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers to equip His people for works of service or ministry. So the body of Christ can be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ." Paul says that God has given some people certain gifts, and as they use those gifts, they use those gifts to then equip the body of Christ, the church, for works of ministry or service. And then as we all use our gifts to serve, then the body of Christ is built up into unity, and then we all become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. What he's saying is that if we don't all use our gifts to serve, then the church will not become united and will not mature, and we will not attain the fullness that God wants us to in Jesus. That every gift is needed. Every gift is necessary for the church to become what God wants it to be. That's why we need everyone in ministry. And part of what this means as well is that as we use our gifts in ministry, that also builds our fellowship. That as we are connected and bonded together in a common identity, that we're all sons and daughters of the King, as we serve together in ministry, doing acts of service for God and others, that then builds our connection with each other and with God. So both fellowship and ministry are working together to deepen us as a church, both with each other and with Jesus. And through that, then God grows His church, like what we see in the book of Acts. They each fulfilled the role they were called to, and the word of God increased, and more disciples came to follow Jesus, even some of the priests. And so our hope is as we grow in our fellowship, our connection with God and each other, as we grow in our ministry, that God will be using us to grow as a church, to become more mature, as we overflow outside our church to reach out to others, to bring more and more people into the kingdom of God. That these fellowship and ministry are about our life as the church, but our focus isn't just on each other. It's then on how we can reach out as the church to our friends, neighbors, co-workers, family members, and tell them the good news of Jesus, so they would come and experience the great love God has revealed to us in His Son, and begin that journey of following Jesus. That's why we need everyone in ministry, everybody serving God and others, to help other people discover God's great love found in Jesus. So what's it mean? Ministry means to serve in faith through the Spirit's power. And it takes all of us. It takes all of us. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your great and amazing love. We thank You that You have loved us so much through Your Son, that You have sent Jesus for us. And God, that You've done this amazing thing. You have served us through Your Son, Jesus, and that now You've called us to serve You and others. And God, that You've empowered us with gifts through Your Holy Spirit. You've given us gifts to use. And so, Father, help us to engage and use those gifts to serve You and others, so that as a church we can grow and be what You want us to be, so that we can see more and more people come find and follow Jesus. So, Father, we thank You for all You're doing in us. And we pray You would lead us and help us find ways to plug in and use our gifts for Your glory. So in Jesus' name that we pray, amen.
Amen. Church, we're going to stand and sing in response if you'd like to sing along.
Amen.
soul. What a joy to sing. Joy to hold, it's when you increase. I want my hands, humble my heart, all that I have is yours. Cover my prayers, light in my eyes, wash me in glorious light. Oh, the joy of me. It's when I decrease, you fill up my soul. What a joy to see, joy to hold, it's when you increase. I want nothing my ears, bridle my tongue, focus my heart to hear. Settle my fears, purge me of pride, again and again you provide. Oh, the joy to feel, joy to know. It's when I decrease, you fill up my soul. What a joy to see, joy to hold. It's when you increase, I want nothing more.
Let's sing it together one last time.
When Jesus came, he said he came not to be served, but to serve. And as Dave showed in his sermon this morning, the various ways to serve, Christ gave us the ultimate example of what it means to serve by the giving of his life for us, for doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. And so as we take communion this morning, if you have your little juice cups here, and if you have your elements at home, let's prepare them and take together. So the first, is the bread. His body sacrificed for us to pay the penalty of sin that we cannot pay for ourselves. Let's take together. Now let's take the juice. The juice represents his blood shed for us. And after that, once the blood has been shed, our sins are forgiven, so we can be in fellowship with God. And we know that God raised Jesus from the dead, so that we might have life eternal with him without sin. Let's take it together.
Thanks, Vic. As we close our service for the day, just a couple of things to be aware of. We've got some awesome opportunities coming up to put God's message to us today through Dave into practice. So we've got some opportunities to go and minister to our community, both in the physical and in the spiritual. First, just a huge thank you to all of you that have taken the baby bottles that have been out front for Real Options Pregnancy Center. Those are due back next week, so if you haven't taken one yet and filled it with change or cash or check, I'm sure they will take any form of money that you want to put in there. They'll take it. So for those of you that have already done that and brought them back, thank you. For those of you that still want an opportunity to minister in that way, you can do that. Feel free to take one on the table and just bring it back next week, so they're due a week from today. And then also on January 31st, we still have three slots available to help out with the Sunshine Soup Kitchen. That will be from 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. So if you're interested in helping that way, if you're interested in ministering that way, you can go and sign up on our website to help with that. And if neither one of those are available to you, or just you're not able to help in those ways, we'll have plenty more options for us to minister coming up in the future. It is, after all, one of our core values to get all of us involved in some way, shape, or form. So with that, let me pray a blessing on us and we can go. God, thank you so much for who you are, for the way that you love us. God, thank you for providing opportunities for us to live out the message of Jesus. God, whether it be through helping people see who you are, through meeting their spiritual needs or meeting their physical needs, God, I pray, Father, that as we leave this place, that you would help us to do just that, to be you to people who need you. And God, help us to take the opportunities that we see, and God, open our eyes to the opportunities that we don't see, to go out and to love one more. Thank you for who you are and for the way that you love us. God, may we now go and minister to others. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Have a great week, guys. God bless.
Your heart. Here.